Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 25th February 2019. The articles we'll be seeing for prelims are these six. First article is about the inclusion of electronic voter machine as information under Right to Information Act. Second article talks about national minimum wages set by a panel at ₹375 per day. Third article is about the data protection clause under new e-commerce policy which may go against the interest of United States of America. Fourth article is about the Financial Action Task Force and its advisory to Pakistan. The fifth article talks about DNA forensics, which is a vital tool for cracking wildlife related crimes. And the final article is about the Ponzi Bill Ordinance Scheme. The first article is about the Central Information Commission's rules to include EVMs as a part of information under Right to Information Act. We all know we have a Right to Information Act enacted in the year 2006, and under this act, the information about the electronic voting machines are now classified as information and they will now come under the ambit of RTI Act. The Central Information Commission has ruled out that the electronic voting machine is coming under the category of information under RTI Act. So this means that on the payment of rupees 10, any information with respect to EVMs can be obtained by a common citizen. Dissatisfaction about the usage of EVMs and increasing doubts about electronic voter machine tamperings. So according to this recent ruling of Central Information Commission, Election Commission has to respond to any RTI application seeking information about EVMs. Earlier, information about EVMs were not provided under RTI since Section 2F of RTI Act, which defined information, did not include electronic voter machine as a category under it. So Section 2F of RTI Act, it deals with any material such as records, documents, memos, emails, opinion, press releases, etc., which can be accessed by a public authority under any law for time being in force. So according to the Central Information Commission's ruling, the information about EVM is now placed in this Section 2F of RTI Act. However, one must also note that EVM model and the samples of the machines are available with the Election Commission, and these samples are only kept for training purposes and they are not saleable to general public. The second article we'll be seeing is Satpathy-led panel has set national minimum wage at ₹375 per day. So this panel has taken into consideration nutritional need for every household in rural as well as urban area while estimating national minimum wages. We'll see about the national minimum wage and also the region-wise classification for this national minimum wage. As per the study, ₹375 per day or ₹9,750 per month is now classified as national minimum wage, and this national minimum wage is irrespective of the skill set, occupation or rural urban locations of any family comprising of 3.6 consumption unit. The panel divided the states of our country into five geographical regions, and this classification into five regions is based on balanced nutritional intake of every family in that region. So according to the report, the balanced nutritional intake of every family is around 2400 calories per day, and keeping in this view, the regions are divided into five categories and each category has different national minimum wage. It has updated the existing guidelines for setting minimum wages, and as per it, population composition should be taken as, according to it, the population composition should be taken into account before fixing minimum wages in a state. The minimum wages should also be able to meet a family's working wage, which means that they must be able to meet their day-to-day food and non-food expenses. And apart from this, the panel has also estimated an additional house rent allowance of about ₹55 per day for the urban workers. The next article we'll be seeing is e-commerce policy for data protection may further annoy USA. We all know recently e-commerce policy has been brought in by the government, and this policy lays special emphasis on data protection norms. And this data protection norms may go against the interest of developed nations such as USA. So the recent draft e-commerce policy released, it lays stringent data protection norms. As per the proposed policy, data must be collected and stored within India. And this data, which is generated and used by e-commerce platforms and also social media and search engines, they must also be kept within the nation. If a business entity collects or processes any sensitive data in India and stores it abroad, such data must also be shared with the Indian authorities when and where required as per the Indian norms. Such placing of norms on data protection acts as an important form of non-tariff barriers, and it comes under WTO clause. So here the USA is opposing this data localization norms. This is because many leading companies, the technological gains, for example, say Amazon, Microsoft or Apple, they are using the global cloud computing business, accessing it from United States of America. So changing this data localization norms will definitely go against the profit margins of United States of America. In January, WTO conducted a 70-country meet consisting of countries like United States, Japan and America, which India did not attend. That negotiation focused on dealing with trade-related aspects of e-commerce. India, along with other developing countries, were not invited for the summit as we are more emphasizing on the data protection norms. The fourth article we'll be seeing is Terror Timeline, Financial Action Task Force Advisory to Pakistan. So the Financial Action Task Force last year has placed Pakistan in its grey list. And after the Pulwama attack few days back, now the Pakistan is in the grave danger of being in the blacklist of Financial Action Task Force. Here for prelims, we'll see about Financial Action Task Force and the implications of placing a country in blacklist of Financial Action Task Force. The Financial Action Task Force has issued a 10-point advisory note on Pakistan. As we all know, Pakistan is already in the grey list of countries posing risk to international system. So if a country is placed in grey list, there will be a decline in foreign transactions and the foreign currency inflows to that country. So if foreign currency transactions are declined, then it can lead to widening of the current account deficit of a country. Apart from this, financial institutions will also think twice before lending loan to Pakistan. Accessing funds from international market will also become tough for such a country. These restrictions are already imposed on Pakistan. And according to this 10-point advisory note released by Financial Action Task Force, if Pakistan is not making necessary compliance measures, it will be blacklisted in the coming session in October 2019. So what does this mean? So if a country is placed in blacklist, it means that there will be enhanced financial scrutiny of the governmental activities. There can even be sanctions imposed on its central bank, and there will be even downgrade of its financial and credit institutions. This will definitely affect the financial health of Pakistan, which is already in debt crisis now. So for prelims, we also need to know about Financial Action Task Force. This Financial Action Task Force is essentially a policy making body. So this body was established in the year 1989. The main objective of Financial Action Task Force is to set standards and promote effective implementations of legal, regulatory and operational measures in order to combat money laundering. Apart from money laundering, terrorist financing and other related threats which pose serious threat to integrity of international financial system are also monitored by Financial Action Task Force. So this body monitors necessary measures to be taken. It also reviews money laundering and terrorist funding techniques and also the related countermeasures to come up with collaborations with international stakeholders at national and international levels. So the main decision-making body of FATF is called as FATF Plenary, and it meets twice a year. The next article we'll be seeing is DNA Forensics, a vital tool for cracking wildlife crimes. So with the improvement in science and technology, DNA forensics can be used as a very important tool in identifying the crimes related to wildlife, and this has been reinforced by recently released a report by Zoological Survey of India. So DNA collection and analysis is very much useful for criminal justice system and justice delivery. And this criminal justice delivery also applies to wildlife crimes. So DNA collection and analysis in this field can be used as a powerful tool for convicting the guilty and thus protecting the innocent. So in a recently released report by Zoological Survey of India, it has quoted that ascertaining species origin from the confiscated meat by using this DNA technology can reduce the false accusation exponentially. We all know India is facing a lot of wildlife crimes, and most of the wildlife crimes, they go unconvicted. This is because of lack of evidence, and this DNA forensics can be used as a very important tool to increase the conviction rate among the wildlife criminals. Apart from this, a reference database for animal species is also being developed by Zoological Survey of India, which can act as a base material in order to develop the DNA forensics to improve the conviction rate. Especially in a country like India, which is ecologically very diverse, many species are badly hunted and poached. For example, species like bagbuck, blue bull, elephant, peacock, spotted deer, tiger are few of the species which are widely hit by poaching. By using DNA forensics technology, this menace of poaching can be reduced widely. The final article for the day is Safety Nets Ponzi Bill Scheme. The president of our country has recently promulgated an ordinance to ban unregulated deposit schemes, thus paving a way to protect the gullible investors from the Ponzi schemes. Under this ordinance on unregulated deposit schemes, there are three types of offences. First type of offences include running of unregulated deposit schemes. Second type of offences include fraudulent default in unregulated deposit scheme. And third one deals with wrongful inductment in relation to unregulated deposit scheme. So by bringing in these types of offences, illegal deposit taking activities in the country can be brought down. This is very much essential to protect the interest of small investors. We all know in India, the savings of low income households have traditionally remained unprotected by the government when compared to those which come from more affluent economic groups. Thus, by bringing in the banning of unregulated deposit scheme ordinance, this bars all deposit schemes in the country that are not officially registered with the government from either seeking or accepting deposits from the customers. So, this ordinance will in turn help in creating a central repository of all the deposit schemes that are currently in operation, thus will make it easier for the government to regulate the activities and thus prevent the frauds being committed against the ordinary people. Thus, the so-called shadow banking instruments such as gold schemes, chit funds, which are traditionally out of government regulations, are now banned and thus protecting the interest of the common households. Thank you.